So at this point, I'd like to introduce the first of our named lectureships for the year. This is the David Sun Lectureship in Postgraduate Education. Some background, the David Sun Lectureship was established by Mrs. Sun in memory of her husband. Dr. Sun died at a young age at the peak of his career. He was an outstanding gastroenterologist, investigator, and both he and his family have been great friends to the college. Another great honor as president is to be able to help choose the lecturers, and this one was easy. Dr. Nicholas Talley is a world-renowned expert in functional gastrointestinal disorders. Not only that, he was the chair of the Department of Internal Medicine at Mayo Clinic in Florida just before me, so Nick was my boss. I didn't choose him because he was my boss, but he was definitely my boss. He did a great job while at Mayo Clinic for a great portion of his career, but eventually relocated back to Australia, and is currently the Pro Vice Chancellor of Global Research at the University of Newcastle in Australia. Everyone in this room has read a Nick Talley paper. He's published over 900 original and review articles. I don't think I could read 900 articles, so that's a pretty impressive research productivity. He was also the co-editor of the American Journal of Gastroenterology from 2004 to 2009, and in that role served as a member of the Board of Trustees of the American College of Gastroenterology. So I'm happy to bring Nick to the stage with his talk, Functional Disease of the Gastrointestinal Tract, Is There a Light at the End of the Tunnel? Dr. Talley.
So ladies and gentlemen, thank you, Ken, and it's a great honor to be here. I'm really very privileged. I looked at the list of previous lecturers, amazing list, and it's wonderful to be part of that. So thank you for having me. I'm going to try and convince you that functional gut diseases are interesting, ladies and gentlemen. Interesting. Some of them are treatable. Some of them are potentially, in inverted commas, curable. But it requires you to recognize those particular syndromes. I'll talk about them. I'll also talk about the common conditions and where they are going and where I hope we will travel further in terms of getting to cure. So lots to cover this morning. I will mention Rome 4. I will talk about curable FGIDs. I will talk about disorders that you should know about, in my view, and hopefully help you manage them more effectively. So let's do it by case-based, as I always, as a clinician, a frontline clinician, just like most of you, I like to think about cases and the cases I've seen. These are real cases, ladies and gentlemen. Here's my first one. A very distinguished public relations president. This gentleman had had recurrent vomiting. He had seen many of my colleagues who had thrown their hands up in despair. He tried every anti-emetic that was known in the pharmacopoeia. And when I asked him, what were the symptoms exactly, he said this: there's this horrible fluid and food that come back up into my mouth. I spit it out sometimes. Usually I spit it out. Very unpleasant, really. Not doing well. I belch a bit as well. I'm a little bit bloated. That was basically the story. The physical exam was unremarkable. He'd already been thoroughly investigated. And ladies and gentlemen, I found his diagnosis from the words he told me, and I was able to provide some useful management. But what do you think is the most likely diagnosis? What do you think in your hands you would have done? Just give you a moment to think about this. This man with unexplained vomiting. And let me just ask you, when was the last time that you personally vomited and kept it in your mouth and spat it out? When was the last time, ladies and gentlemen? When? And clearly, he's not vomiting. That's the core issue. He actually describes a classic syndrome of effortless regurgitation. He's also got a belching disorder, although who cares? And he doesn't have IBS because he hasn't got any of the features on the history, although I didn't tell you those. So he's got rumination, and ladies and gentlemen, this is a potentially curable condition. This responds to behavioral therapy, and you can teach diaphragmatic rebreathing, or you can actually apply other biofeedback. You can diagnose this objectively with esophageal impedance, but quite frankly, the history is sufficient in most clear-cut cases, at least in my view. And if you want to teach diaphragmatic breathing, the slide here has the reference and a small description of what you have to do. The Spanish have done other biofeedback that's also been helpful. What about another case? This man is truly vomiting. He has absolute classic vomiting. Recurrent episodes, an 11-year history. It's episodic. It lasts for up to 3 days. Usually begins in the morning, not related to food, no other prodrome, physical exams normal. The only real clue in the history is when he sits in his hot bathtub or in the shower, it helps his vomiting. So what do you think's the most likely diagnosis here? And here's a list of possibilities, and there are a number, although, again, the history is the clue. And this bathing compulsively strongly suggests he has drug-induced vomiting. And of course, most of you know what it is, even though he initially denied taking it. But here it is. He was taking cannabis. And he was. And so cannabis can also lead to functional gut syndromes. And there's a cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome that's recognized by the Rome criteria. And this is part of the cyclic vomiting syndrome, now well recognized in adults. It's an important diagnosis to recognize because it's not just cannabis that's the issue here. This syndrome responds reasonably well to tricyclic antidepressants. So remember this syndrome. My particular patient here refused to stop the cannabis. He said it helped his vomiting, even though he kept vomiting. So I gave him a tricyclic, and he did very well. So curable functional gut syndromes, I've mentioned two of them, rumination and the cannabis hyperemesis syndrome. But don't forget about narcotic bowel syndrome. This is where you get an aggravation of abdominal pain with increasing doses of narcotics. It's a very important syndrome to recognize because you need to get these patients off the narcotics. That's what you need to try and do. And then there's chronic constipation due to pelvic floor dyssynergia that will respond to biofeedback. And quite frankly, a good rectal exam can be very helpful in screening. That's not during colonoscopy. That's when they're awake and alert. You need to do that rectal exam. It can help you because when they squeeze your finger so tightly you can't even pull it out, when they're straining, you know, ladies and gentlemen, there's a problem. Let's take another case. A 39-year-old man, a divorced physician, basically had this syndrome of upper GI symptoms, which in fact he was sent to me with the diagnosis of PPI-resistant GERD. And he did have a little bit of heartburn, but his main problem was early satiety, inability to finish a normal-sized meal. He also had postprandial fullness, bloating, some epigastric pain, typically after meals. And this was a problem he developed after he'd actually been here in wonderful Las Vegas and got acute gastroenteritis, at least by history. He tried PPI. This had been a complete failure. Physical exam was normal. He had a negative endoscopy. He was H. pylori negative. So what do you think the diagnosis is here? And indeed, you could pick a couple of different possibilities out of the list I have. Some people will call this functional heartburn, but I'd like to argue this patient has typical functional dyspepsia. He has postprandial distress syndrome. Yes, he has a whiff of heartburn, but that is not the primary driver of his symptoms, I would argue. I'll come back to that during the rest of the presentation. But this patient has PDS based on the Rome 4 diagnostic criteria that were published this year. And the symptom of early satiety is really the clue, and it's the important symptom to recognize. It's often not asked about. Unless you ask specifically, you may miss the diagnosis and end up misclassifying the patient, as I would argue was the case in this particular patient scenario. How common is early satiety? In the United States, this is more prevalent than heartburn. And I think, again, many physicians don't recognize how common this particular symptom is. It's highly, highly prevalent. And most of these cases, I would argue, actually, if it's a significant symptom, have a functional dyspepsia-like syndrome. What's the epidemiology? Well, one of the best studies, I would argue, although I'm a little bit biased as we did this study, so forgive me, but this is a study where we went to Sweden and we offered a free endoscopy to the general population. Yes, it was free. They got a T-shirt. And what's more, it was an unsedated free upper endoscopy. And 80% agreed to come in to the study. Yes, they did. And this is one of the better studies because we were able to look at symptoms and endoscopic correlation. And indeed, 16% of the population had typical functional dyspepsia symptoms with a normal upper endoscopy, and the majority had postprandial distress syndrome. Now, what was interesting is when we went back to Mayo Clinic and looked at diagnoses of patients with upper GI symptoms in the clinic, we found amongst Olmsted County residents, they're all the people who live around the Mayo Clinic and use Mayo as their primary care site, it was interesting that even though GERD was very well recognized, functional dyspepsia was underdiagnosed, grossly under-recognized, even though patients had the typical symptoms and were appropriately investigated, and the diagnosis from chart review was very obvious. So we miss FD, we often call it GERD, and when they fail PPI, we call it PPI-resistant GERD, and then we're lost in the testing. What else is linked to functional dyspepsia? Well, irritable bowel syndrome overlaps. And what's really interesting is irritable bowel syndrome, like functional dyspepsia, can occur after an acute bout of gastroenteritis. And indeed, some of these people not only get irritable bowel syndrome, they also get functional dyspepsia overlap. So post-infectious functional gut syndromes are very common, actually, and often, again, under-recognized. So what are some other facts you should know besides the fact that GERD's often a misdiagnosis and there's an overlap with IBS and the post-infectious syndrome? Well, gastric emptying is often performed in patients with functional dyspepsia to look for gastroparesis. But quite frankly, that is generally quite unhelpful in your management algorithm in most cases. The one potential exception is when you're thinking about antidepressant therapy, and the reason that's relevant is in the functional dyspepsia treatment trial, it was clear in this trial that while amitriptyline appeared to be better than placebo, in those with slow gastric emptying, there was no benefit of the low-dose tricyclic antidepressant. So I think that's really the one time gastric emptying can help you. But in general, if your patients are not vomiting, not losing weight, and they have classical functional dyspepsia symptoms, looking for gastroparesis will not affect your management plan. Another fact is there's a group of functional dyspepsia patients who have an infectious cause for their functional dyspepsia. And the best example of this is H. pylori dyspepsia, now recognized by the Rome criteria grouping as being a separate disorder. So the message is you should look for Helicobacter. If they're positive with functional dyspepsia, you can offer therapy and there is a benefit. Interestingly, the association here is mostly with epigastric pain rather than postprandial distress. And then there's a new kid on the block, and this is duodenal inflammation in functional dyspepsia. And this is linked most closely to early satiety. And if you look at this diagram, you can actually see a case we have here where there's eosinophil degranulation right next to the nerves here in the duodenal biopsy. This work began with a study about 10 years ago now. This is again from that Swedish population-based endoscopy study where we were able to show clusters of eosinophils in many of the patients with functional dyspepsia compared with controls, and an increase in the duodenal eosinophil count in these patients. Nobody believed us, of course, and right now there are groups around the world who are still somewhat cautious about these findings. But if you look at other data, these results have been confirmed. So, for example, this is work from Belgium, from Jan Tak's group, where they've looked at duodenal eosinophilia in functional dyspepsia, and again, they show increased duodenal eosinophils. Some of these people also had increased mast cells, and there was a decrease in duodenal, or an increase in duodenal permeability in these cases that correlated with the inflammatory infiltrate. And what's more, in a very elegant study published in the Red Journal recently, they were able to show that this duodenal infiltrate was also linked to neuronal, structural, and functional abnormalities. In other words, it looks as if this subtle, and it is a subtle, duodenal eosinophilia with or without mast cells is linked to real alterations in function of the duodenal tract. And there are groups all over the world that have identified this, from Japan to elsewhere in the world where these findings have been replicated. The problem is, to find this abnormality, the pathologist has to learn to count. They have to count 5 high-power fields, the number of eosinophils that are present. It's not difficult, but getting people to do this has proven more difficult than I would have expected. But if they've got more than 22 eosinophils in 5 high-power fields, that in our hands is abnormal and appears to correlate with the presence of symptomatology. What's more, in other work that's been done as well, there's been clear evidence of circulating, homing small intestinal T cells. This is a signature of small intestinal inflammation, and these cells correlate with slow gastric emptying. There's also a cytokine response that's been demonstrated. In other words, some of the motility abnormalities in the gastric area may well be related to small intestinal inflammation in a subset with functional dyspepsia. So what may cause these changes? Well, there's evidence the microbiome's abnormal, a recent paper just in Gut. Food antigens may be relevant. And we found in a study from Sydney, Australia, that if you kept herbivore pets, you had an increased risk. Herbivore pets include things like horses. And for those who keep horses, they know they are full of parasites, ladies and gentlemen. Absolutely chock-a-block full of parasites. And why does reflux disease overlap? It's really interesting. There is some evidence that fundic disaccommodation, failure of relaxation of the fundus, which occurs in about 40% with functional dyspepsia, that leads to increased TLESRs, transient lower esophageal sphincter relaxations. What's more, we showed work at DDW this year that if you've got duodenal eosinophilia, you're 18-fold more likely to have reflux symptoms develop, new onset reflux symptoms 10 years later. We think they're all interlinked. So there's a model for postprandial distress syndrome in particular, which starts with duodenal inflammation and ends with reflux disease, as well as systemic features that may well be accounted for by a gut-brain mechanism. And what about pharmacotherapy? Well, I mentioned helicobacter therapy, although most even who are infected will fail. PPIs work in FD. They also reduce duodenal eosinophils, just like they reduce esophageal eosinophils. H2 blockers work better than PPIs in the meta-analyses. Broader confidence limits, but work better. We think histamine blockers may well be of value. And other drugs, we don't know, but it's clearly an area where we need to do more work in terms of suppressing duodenal eosinophils to move forward. Let me move to another case. This is a 47-year-old woman now with symptoms for 6 months. 6 months. And she's got postmenopausal symptoms as well as bloating, lower abdominal pain, a bit of early satiety. She's constipated. She describes some urinary frequency. Abdominal exams benign. Colonoscopy's negative. And she was sent to me for management of irritable bowel syndrome. So do you think this woman with 6 months of symptoms, who's postmenopausal, most likely has IBS or something else? And I guess the answer would be it's probably IBS, but in fact, she didn't have IBS because when we did a transvaginal ultrasound, and in fact I could feel this, she had an ovarian cancer. And in fact, she has absolutely classical symptoms of ovarian cancer. This is a rare diagnosis, but it's something you can miss in someone who is thought to have IBS. So I'm just, I guess, emphasizing, think outside the track. Don't rely on the Rome criteria totally, or much at all, actually. You've got to be very careful. In terms of subtypes of IBS, we still have, according to Rome 4, you know, these subtypes of constipation and diarrhea predominant and mixed type, and we can talk about that. What about the pathogenesis, though? I think we're making progress. You heard this morning Larry talk about fecal transplant trials for IBS because the microbiome is disturbed, and that is true. There's also T-cell dysfunction, we think, in some cases, with a low-grade mast cell-type inflammatory response in a subset with IBS and diarrhea. There's an immune response, too. which may explain some of the symptoms. And a number of these patients will bloat or indeed have visible abdominal distension, like they're pregnant, and this may well be from gas release into the intestinal tract, distending the gut, leading to a reflex response, a somatic reflex response that leads to diaphragmatic failure to relax, so their stomach or abdomen protrudes. So it's a real syndrome. So what about facts for IBS? Well, I think you can still make a positive diagnosis, but be careful of some of the rare but important differentials. Celiac disease remains an important mimicker. Tests should be kept to a minimum, but we probably do need to do some basic tests before we make that final diagnosis. But normally, when you're putting the scope in, you know it's IBS, ladies and gentlemen. You just know, don't you? And when they squirm on the table, if they're not having propofol, when they squirm on the table, you know even more they've got IBS. A negative colonoscopy is what you'll normally find. There's fascinating data, less polyps, less adenomas in IBS. Nobody knows why. It's a very interesting observation. And colonoscopy doesn't do much for reassurance. I'm sorry, there's not much data, but the data that's out there says it doesn't reassure these people. They're just as unhappy afterwards as they were before. You can use biomarkers. I don't have time to talk about these except to say there are biomarkers, and I think there'll be more for positive diagnosis. We need a better biomarker approach, but there are some interesting tests available. What about the future? Well, we've got to find the causes. So let me give you two examples of possible causes of IBS in my view. One is this chronic infection of the colon known for 100 years, colonic spirochetosis. We published two studies now, we found this is linked to IBS with diarrhea and a very, very specific colonic pathology that seems to have been missed for 100 years. I don't know why. We think this might account for up to, and we're not sure, 2% of IBS. This needs to be treated in a randomized trial to establish that indeed. And then there's a genetic cause of IBS too. This is the SCN5A gene. This is the gene linked to Brugada syndrome in cardiology, but also linked to IBS. It's a sodium channel gene. And if you reverse the sodium channel abnormality with something like mexiletine in a proof of concept study at least, it appears to reverse IBS. In other words, there is at least one genetic syndrome may well account for up to 2% with IBS. There's only 96% to go, ladies and gentlemen, for finding all the causes. What about treatment? I like diet. Diet is worth considering. A low FODMAP diet may not be much better than the traditional diet, although this particular traditional diet did actually exclude some FODMAPs. But the bottom line is about half the patients have a pretty good response. So think about diet. What about treatment in terms of traditional therapies? There are a number of traditional therapies I haven't got time to cover, except to say some of them have evidence, but none of these therapies change natural history of IBS, which is disappointing. In terms of newer therapies, I want to point out that rifaximin does change the natural history. It's the only drug I'm aware of that when you give it and then stop it and then watch people, their symptom improvement persists for at least a period of time. The problem with rifaximin, you have to retreat because everybody eventually fails, or at least seems to. So that is a real problem. What about some new therapies? Remember I mentioned mast cells? It's interesting, histamine blockade, H1 blockers, yes, the old-fashioned H1 blockers in one RCT look like they had a very significant difference from placebo in IBS with diarrhea. I think that's a fascinating observation, an observation that needs following up. I am using H1 and H2 blockers in my practice much more than I've ever used them for these functional syndromes with good results. And then you'll hear at this year's ACG on Monday at the Presidential Plenary, some work from Mayo Clinic from our group, led by Yuri Saito, on pregabalin, showing pregabalin helps IBS pain. First RCT of pregabalin in the world to be published in IBS, to my knowledge. So, ladies and gentlemen, I want to wrap it up. I want to make sure you hopefully remember some of these points, that rumination is a syndrome you can diagnose. You just need to take the history. Yes, you can confirm with esophageal impedance, but quite frankly, you don't need to in most cases. Don't miss cyclic vomiting. Very characteristic history. You need to take the history to make the diagnosis. Cannabinoid hyperemesis, another classic syndrome that you can pick up with the history. Some patients will forget to tell you they take cannabis. They'll just forget. But you can check this, of course, if you wish, with urine drug screens, or you can just retake the history. And then don't forget the rectal exam. The rectal exam is useful in functional gut disorders to rule out impaction, which sometimes can be really problematic in someone with so-called diarrhea predominant IBS. They haven't got diarrhea, they've got constipation, and also can be helpful in screening for pelvic floor dyssynergia. Don't forget about early satiety. I think it's an absolutely classic symptom of FD, and if they've got that symptom, think about functional dyspepsia because your management algorithm is different. And as for IBS, make a positive diagnosis. Remember the value of colonoscopy, but also its limitations. And of course, screen for other diseases. Thank you very much indeed.